So, in today's lecture, we actually continue with more advanced topics of object-oriented programming. So, the first topic that we are going to talk about is actually a topic that we learned about in the last few minutes when we talked about the get and set methods in object-oriented programming. So, the problem is if our data fields are private, we can get access to these data fields with get methods, but if we don't provide any set methods, then our objects are immutable. Once they are created, we cannot change the content of those objects. And there is a reason for that. If for applications that basically are multi-threaded, that multiple processes are running in parallel using the same space in memory, we would like to minimize the ways that they can communicate with each other. And one way to do that is that each of the classes, each of the threads or of the processes can actually create an object, use it, but not modify it. Because otherwise there will be issues about racing of multiple threads to have access to objects in memory. And for that, we have to implement different ways to basically synchronize the access of those objects to the same, to of those processes to the same objects in memory. The easiest way to implement such multi-threaded applications are with immutable objects and classes. What exactly is an immutable object? It's an object that is not mutable. It's an object where the content of the object cannot be changed once the object is created. And classes, which are basically templates for objects that can only be immutable, are called immutable classes. Classes that basically, if you create an object of that class, after the creation of the object cannot be changed. An example of an immutable class would be the class Circle that we defined in the previous lecture, where we have the data field radius as private, and we have an accessor to give us a copy of that radius, basically a copy of that double value, but we don't have any set method. So the radius is private, and since we don't have a set method, we cannot change its value. However, a class where all the data fields are private and without mutators is not necessarily immutable. The reason is that we actually make also store in the data fields references to other objects that may be mutable. So as an example, basically we will see that we can create a class student or person that has as a data field a date of birth. All of the data fields are private. It has only accessors, no mutators. However, is not an immutable object, and the class is not immutable. So, what actually is a class that is immutable? It marks all the data fields as private. It provides no mutator methods, no set methods, and provides no accessor methods, no get methods that would return a reference to a mutable data field object. And as I said, the reason is that we may actually get a reference to a mutable data field. We want to minimize the way that objects can change in memory. And here is the example. Let's assume that we want to implement some kind of an application where we have a class student, and we want once the student is created not to be modified in memory. And we implemented the class student in a manner that it gives the impression that it is immutable. However, it is mutable. So first, we define the data fields of student both as private. We have the private data field ID and the private birth date object of the type birth date. We can create a student using the constructor student, and the constructor takes the social security number, year, month, and day as formal parameters. The ID is assigned to the formal parameter SSN, so the data field is assigned SSN as an identifier. The birthday is assigned the reference of a new object of the type birthday for the year, month, and day. We can see that we only provide accessor methods to this class. We get the ID and we get the reference to the birthday. So if we would only have the first two rules, that all the data fields are private and we have no mutators, then the class should be immutable. However, if the birth date is mutable, then also student is mutable. So let's see why. Birth date is actually just a class with the data fields year, month, and day. And it has a constructor birth date that takes an integer year, an integer month, and an integer day, and assigns them to the data fields year, month, and day. We have an accessor for the year that returns the year, and a mutator for the year that sets the year to a different year. Next, we create a new student, and this new student has the ID 11122333, and is born on January 1st, 1998. The birthday for this student is, we can get it with the getBirthday method, which is just an accessor to the in the student class for the data field birthday. We can actually use the mutator set year to set a new year for the date that we got as birth date. And now we actually, if we print the year of birth of that student, which is student.getBirthDate.getYear, it will print 2020, 2050, which obviously is actually a way to modify the student data field. And the reason for that is that student has actually a reference to an object of the type birth date, which can modify. So our class student is not immutable. It basically, although nothing changes in the class student, the values that the student may have for data fields actually change themselves. Like for instance, the birthday for this student. So again, I always like to actually show you this working. So I'm going to create two classes in Eclipse. First, we are going to create the class birthDate. So like in the class birthDate, we are going to create, let's say, even private data fields for year, month, and day. We create a public constructor for birthDate, which creates a new birth date with the given integers, let's say new year, new month, and new day. And we assign them to the data fields. So year is assigned new year, month is assigned new month, and day is assigned new day. Now we can provide, because those were private, we can provide accessors and mutators. So we can, for instance, define the accessor get year, which returns the year of birth, and a mutator set year, which takes an integer new year and assigns it to the year data field. Okay, now let's create the class student. So a student has an ID, let's again define it as private, even, yeah, integer is fine for ID. Birth, private birth date. And we can create a constructor for student that that takes the SSN, the year, month, and day, and assigns the SSN to the ID and assigns to the birth date a new birth date object with a given year, month, and day. And as I said, we can actually not have any mutators for this class. We can only provide an accessor to the birth date. Okay, so now this class is complete. Let's actually implement our test for student class. So test student, we can create a new student. Let's call it Paul, and Paul is a new student. With the social security number, this one, and let's say the year is 2000, younger, January 1st. And now for Paul, we can get the year, the birth date, and we can set the year to a different year. Maybe Paul was born in the future, in 2050. So Paul is now mutable. If I print the birthday, of Paul, it will print 2050 instead of 2000. Okay. So although the student class, everything was private and we had only an accessor get birth date, we didn't have a mutator for the birth date, the class birth date was mutable. It had a mutator for the birth date. Okay, so that's why all for a class to be really immutable, all the data fields must be private. It should have no mutators and it should provide no accessor methods that will return a reference to a mutable data field object. Now let's talk about variables. The scope of data fields can be declared, the scope of data fields is the entire class, which is different than the local variables. Local variables are available between their declaration up to the end of the block that contains that variable. A local variable must be also initialized explicitly, while data fields have default values. And again, we can see this difference in an example. So let's actually write a test program. In the test, let's assume that this is a class, and in the class test we can define a public static variable integer x is equal with 1. Although x was defined at the end of the class, in the main method which is above it, I can actually use the variable x. So the scope of x is in fact the entire class. I can print x and it's printing fine. So although this variable is declared here, it's available in the entire class. Okay? And the same happens with data fields. I can put my data fields at the end of my class, although that's not usually done. But they are available within the entire class. So you can see here that I'm using number of objects, I'm using radius, and I'm assigning value to them, although they are defined at the end of the class. And this is different than local variables. For local variables, like for instance, if I define the variable y is available between the point that it was defined up to the end of the method in which it was defined. I cannot use y before it was actually defined. This will be a syntax error. I basically am told that I should define it before I use it. And that was not the case for global variables. Another issue with local variables versus global variables is that local variables must be initialized before they are used into an expression. I get an error if I don't have an assigned value to y, but I'm trying to use the local variable y to print its value. But I do not have that problem for data fields. I can actually print the value of x, although x was never initialized to a value, and it will print 0. Because numbers have a default value of 0. And similarly for other types, like for instance, numbers have a default value of 0, but other types, like for instance, if I define the variable x to be boolean, will have a default value of false. So boolean has a default value of false. Character or car has a default value of the Unicode, the character of with Unicode 0000, which is an invisible character. And any kind of reference type variable have a default value of null, which is the null reference, reference that basically does not have a value. So for instance, if x would be a string, then x, printing x would print null, you see? Okay. So that's the difference between data fields, which are basically fields for class objects and static fields, and local variables. Local variables must be declared and initialized before they are used. Data fields should be declared within the class, but their scope is the entire class, which is the textual part of the program where they can be used. So they can be declared at the end of the class, and they are available within the entire class before they were declared even. The same applies to local to values. They are initialized with default values, while local variables must be initialized if they are used. Okay, now one thing that we haven't talked about is what if the name of a formal parameter is the same with a data field? How can we access that data field? Like for instance, in our class circle, I made a choice that, let's return back to the class circle. Let's delete the extra stuff. Just leave only the class circle with a constructor. Okay. So what if the name of the data field is not new radius, but it's radius? Now, there is actually a conflict of the fact that radius is a data field and radius is a formal parameter. If I assign radius equal radius, in fact, nothing really happens because basically to the local formal parameter radius, I'm assigning its own value, which is does not change the global, the data field radius. So how do I access the data field radius? I can access sit with a special keyword called this. This is a keyword, is the name reference to the object itself. So if I'm implementing a non-static method, in that non-static method, I can access the either other methods or data fields of the current object using the this keyword. It's basically a reference to the object itself. If I have hidden data fields where which are hidden by local variables with the same name, I can access those hidden data fields with the keyword this. This is a keyword, this is a reference to the current object. It refers to the current object. Also, I can use it to call other constructors of the same class. So instead of re-implementing incrementing the number of objects twice in each one of the constructors, I can invoke another constructor from the current constructor of the same class. So let's return to our example. Let's assume that I had that private static keyword number of objects. Initially it was 0. I can have a public constructor circle where I increment the number of objects. And I would also like to increment that number of objects in the other class. I would like to increment it here in the other constructor. But you see that this is duplicated code. I'm actually writing the same code that I will have here, here. So instead of doing this, I can call the first constructor of circle from the second constructor of circle. So what this does is actually it calls this of no parameters, calls the first constructor. It increments the number of objects even in the second constructor. And that's the second use, to enable a constructor to invoke another constructor of the same class as the first statement of the current constructor. So let's see these two uses. First, the reference to hidden data fields. So we have the class foo. The class foo contains a data field I with a default value of 5. We have a method setI, which takes as a formal parameter the green I. And we want to assign that green I to the global I, to the data field I, as a parameter, as a value. If I would write only I equal I, then I'm assigning to the local variable I the value of the local variable I, which is not doing anything for the global variable I, the yellow I. If I'm using this dot I, that then I'm assigning to the current object, because I'm in a non-static method, I'm assigning to the current object data field I the value of the local formal parameter I. So this dot I refers, depending on for which object we are calling, the data field I for that object. So suppose that F1 and F2 are two objects of the type foo, and we are invoking for F1 set I to the value 10, which will evaluate basically for that object F1 will change the value of I to 10. So this of I really refers to the object F1. While invoking F2.setI to 45, again when executing this.I equal with 45, this refers to the second object F2. So this in either case actually refers to the current object. Okay. Similarly, if I have a static data field K and I want to assign it a different value in a method that already has a variable with the name K, I can access the static data field K using the class name, like foo.k is assigned K. The local K is assigned to the global K, static variable K. Any questions? Feel free to ask also questions during a lecture because, okay, excellent question. So the next question is, what about this with parentheses? So this with parentheses is used when we want to invoke another constructor of the same class. So for instance, let's say that we have a constructor for circle that takes a radius as a parameter and assigns to this.radius, the global radius, the value of the local parameter radius. Now, if we have another constructor like circle with no parameters and we would like to assign the value 1.0, We would have to copy the same code that we have above to write this.radius is equal with 1.0. But every time that you have code application in your class is actually a possibility for errors. Because if you made the error first time, if you copy that code and paste it in a different location, now you have two errors in the program. How to avoid it? You avoid it usually with methods, which say that try to extract everything that is executed twice in a separate method. But in this case, we don't need a third method, or in fact a fourth method, because we can actually invoke from the second constructor, the default no argument constructor, we can invoke the first constructor. How? We can use the keyword this. As long as you are putting this call, this of parentheses, and then you enumerate the parameters of the other constructor, you can actually put it at the beginning of any constructor to call another constructor of the same class. The only thing to be careful about is not to have cycles. So you can't call a constructor for a class from another constructor that basically is called by the constructor of the, like two constructors are calling each other in a cycle. That will be detected as a compiler error. But as long as you only have like trees of calling constructors, like one constructor calls another constructor and that's it, you can actually call it with this of parentheses. Okay. Also, we saw that the keyword this can be actually used for accessing data fields. However, if we don't have local variables in that method with the same name with a data field, you can omit that keyword this period the radius. So you can get instance variables, data fields with the keyword this, but since you are not using the radius as a local variable in this method, it's normally to omit the keyword this. So the same code can be written the way that we've wrote it up to now. Like for instance, in getArea, if we implement the method getArea, we can return either this.radius multiplied with this.radius. Multiplied with the value of pi. But we can also omit this because there is no error, there is no local variable radius, so there is no need to actually call this. This is really used when you are hiding the global or the data field, the instance variable, through a variable with the same name in the method, or you are calling a different constructor of the same class. Basically, in this code, we call first the default constructor, then we return and we execute the rest of this method. Okay. Good. No more questions. Good. Okay. So we talked a little bit about encapsulation. But encapsulation basically means something more than just encapsulation. It means an abstraction or a class abstraction. The fact that we are separating how the class is implemented from the use of the class. Us, the creator of the class, will provide a description of the class, basically the set of public methods, and let the user know how that class is used by using documentation, Java doc documentation in every method. And the user doesn't really know, doesn't need to know how is the class implemented. The class is encapsulated and the implementation we say that is hidden. So really the class implementation is like a black box hidden from clients, because the clients will use the class through that contract, the class contract, which is the signatures of all the public methods and public constants, but the class implementation is actually hidden. We don't really need to know how, let's say, binary search is implemented. We can use it as a method. We know that it's implemented, tested, debugged, and we know that it's correct. So this is the fact that all our data fields encapsulation should be done through making private all of our data fields and making public all of our methods. So here we have an example. Let's assume that we work for a bank and we are asked to implement a class of loan. So different people take different loans and we want to store in memory the different loans that we made to people. So for instance, what are the data fields that we need to store for such loan classes? Like for a loan, we have to store the annual interest rate, which is a percentage, like for instance, 2.5% per year, the annual interest rate of the loan. The number of years, for instance, but default could be 1 year. You buy a cell phone and you get a loan for 1 year. The loan amount, for instance, 1,000, the default value, and the loan date. What's the date when the loan was created? But really, these are hidden from the customer. The customer will not need to know all of these details. They only need to know basically the public signature of the class. The class can be objects can be constructed either with the default constructor or the constructor that takes the annual interest rate, number of years, and the loan amount. We can access the annual interest rate. We can get the double value for that annual interest rate percentage. We can get the number of years, the loan amount, the loan date. We can set to a different annual interest rate. We can set to a different number of years, to a different loan amount. We can get complex computations of the monthly payment, how much compound interest is added to our loan and how much we should pay every month. We can get the total payment for that specific loan. So let's see an example. For instance, for the class loan, the annual interest rate is set to be the default value of 2.5. The number of years is 1. The loan amount is 1,000 by default. And the loan date will be created when we create a loan object. So the constructor loan, the public no argument constructor for the loan, will call the other constructor. It calls this of a double, an integer, and another double, which in fact is the second constructor, the loan that takes the annual interest rate as a double, the number of years as an integer, and the loan amount as a double. So what we are actually doing here, we are overloading the constructors. We are overloading that we can create loan with a default constructor, or we can create loan with a constructor that takes the annual interest rate, number of years, and loan amount. And again, we use the keyword this to assign to the data fields an annual interest rate, the formal parameter annual interest rate, same thing for number of years and loan amount. Finally, loan date does not have a local variable with the same name, so we can directly assign to loan date data field the current date as a new Java util.date object. If we can, we can also implement additional methods. We can implement accessors and mutators for these encapsulated data fields, annual interest rate, number of years, and loan. But we can implement additional methods like get monthly payment. Will compute a complex formula for monthly payment. Basically, it adds the monthly interest rate and it divides the number of years, it divides the number of months with 12. Similarly, if we want the total payment for the loan, we can multiply the monthly payment with the number of years with the value of 12 months per year. Okay. Let's assume that we work for a different company, a company that it's a gym, and we want for every customer to basically tell the customer what is their BMI and status. So we have to remember the customer name, the age of the customer, the weight and the height. And the BMI is computed based on this weight and height. And therefore, we will need to compute basically the way to compute that BMI from the age, from the weight and the height. Sometimes also we consider the age or the gender for the constructors. So in this case, we actually do exactly that implementation. These are all classes that you can actually copy and paste from the lecture notes, and they actually are working in Java as they are written. So feel free when you read the lecture notes to actually just copy the implementation in Java. So let's actually do that now. And instead of this code, I just pasted and formatted the code for BMI. So for instance, it will compute the BMI for any person. In this case, basically, we have the weight and height in pounds and inches. For the BMI, we have to transform those to kilograms and meters. So we basically compute the rate BMI. And based on that BMI, based on the value of the BMI, we actually tell the user what kind of state, the status the user is. Okay. So let's assume that we have a different task. Basically, we are now teaching assistants for a class and we want to actually remember all the students that are in that class. And for that, we implement a class course. We may be actually teaching assistants for multiple classes, for a class Computer Science 1, for a Principles of Programming Languages class, and so on. So for that, we need a name of the class, an array of student strings, which is basically an array of names of the students that take the class, and an integer number of students, which basically determines how many students from that class are actually, how many students in that array are actually initialized to a value. So for that, we actually create a constructor course that takes the name of the class, and then we can add students with the add method. One by one, it will increment the number of students and assign to the next element in students the student that we are adding. We can get the array of all the students and we can get the number of students. So let's actually test this program. So what we are going to do, we are going to create multiple courses with different number of students. In this case, we start with an array of students of 100 students. The number of students by default is 0, so when we create a new course, we will have an array of 100 elements, but the actual students are 0. There are no students yet initialized. Then we can add student by student by incrementing, by assigning to the student array at the number of students the student, and incrementing the number of students with 1. We can get both that array, the number of students, we can get the course name, or we can actually iterate over the students and select all the students in a list. Okay? So in order to understand how this works, let's actually create a class for it and try it. So we are going to create a new class. Let's call it course. So again, we are going to have multiple steps. First, we need to implement a course class. So we need a private, let's say, string name of the specific class and a private string array students and also a private integer number of students. Now we can create a constructor. Let's define the constructor course that takes a string representation of the name of the class. Let's call it name. And in that case, we have to use the keyword this to assign to the class name the formal parameter name. So we can already start testing this class. So let's assume that we have 2 courses. This summer, CSC 114, which is a new course for the class CSC 114. And maybe another class. Let's say CSC 307. Which is CSC 307. We would like now to actually print these classes. For that, we can actually implement a method that returns a string representation of this class. So let's call it toString, which defines a string. Let's call it s, assigned first with the name of the class, and then we return the string. So in this case, if we try to print, that class CSC114.toString, and the same for CSC307. Even if we don't put the toString, it actually calls that by default. It will print the names of the two classes. Now let's start adding students to these classes. So we are going to implement non-static methods add student, and it takes as a parameter the name of the student. Let's say s for student name. So how can we do this? We can actually assign to students of number of students plus plus the name of the student. So this will both assign to students of number of students the student and or s and increment the number of students with 1. So now in our toString method we can actually also add to that string the students. So we can write a loop over all the students whose ID is less than or whose index is less than the number of students. And increment s or add to s. Also, let's say that we had here a string. The name of the student followed by a comma. And we are going to add additional students in both classes. So let's say that in CSE114 we are adding Mary, and we are also adding John. And in 307, we are adding Anne, and we are adding Bob. So now we have two classes. Basically, if we print them, let's see where we have the error. Oh, we didn't create the array of students. Let's say that by default we have 100 students. Excellent. It will print. We are not adding the name, we are adding the name of the student. Students of I. Excellent. So now we have 114 has these students, Mary and John. 307 has the students Anne and Bob. Okay? But what if we are actually adding more than the number of students? Let's say that we add 200 students, or our initial array was not of size 100 but was of size 2, and we are adding 3 students to each one of these classes. Mary, John, and Richard. So, in order to fix that, we really have to see if the number of students is actually the size of the array is actually greater than equal with the number of students. So we have to modify our method addStudents to do the following. If the number of students is strictly less than the size of the array, then we are fine. If it's greater than equal with the size of the array, students.length, what we have to do is to create a new array of students, of strings. Let's call it new students, as a new string array of the size of students multiplied with 2. Basically, we double the size of the array. Then we have to copy the students from the old array into the new array. So we copy from students at index 0 into new students at index 0, and the number of elements that we copy is students.length. And then we can redirect the reference of students to new students. Okay, so now it doesn't matter how many students we are adding. Every time that the array is not big enough to store all the students, it creates a new array with double the size. It copies the students from the original array starting from index 0 into the new array starting from index 0, and the number of students in the original array. And then we redirect the students reference to this new reference, which is new students. And then we have enough space to store as many students as we want. It doesn't matter what's the original size. It could be even 1, and it's still fine enough. It will basically duplicate to 2 and then to 4. So now the size of the array is really 4, and we actually created 2 arrays that we copied and then we discarded. They became garbage. Okay, great. So we are getting into arrays with objects, like for instance, strings. Okay. Which actually gives us the first type of data structure that we are going to talk about in Java, which is a stack. So we talked a little bit about stacks before. In the first lecture, we said that the invocation of methods is done on a stack. The meaning of a stack is really a data structure where we can actually put objects, an unlimited number of objects in the data structure with a method called push. We basically push the data and it always pushes it onto the top of the data structure. And then we can pop the data. Popping means take the element from the top of the data structure and delete it from the data structure. So the main two methods that are available for stacks are push and pop. Push puts elements in the data structure, pop pops out the elements from the top of the data structure. It is like a pyramid. You can only put objects on the top, and you can take objects from the top of the data structure. So mainly, this is a very simple data structure where internally it may be storing the elements as an array, but as methods available to this data structure, we have push and pop. Push pushes an element to the top of the stack. Pop returns the element from the top of the stack and deletes it. Get size returns the number of elements in the stack. Pick returns the element on the top of the stack without deleting it. Empty returns true if the stack is empty and false otherwise. And stack of integers constructor either constructs a default stack of integers or a stack of integers with the default size of 16. But that's only the starting size, because in essence, every time we need more space, we will just create a bigger array, copy the elements from the old array into the new array, and actually then redirect the array elements to the new array. So the elements may be stored in an array, but the access to them is done through these methods, push and pop. The original size is initialized with 0, and then we can access the elements of the array and add elements in that stack. And here is basically an implementation. So the original elements array has a given capacity of that array. and starts with elements of 0 for the bottom of the stack. And then as we push additional elements, they actually enter in elements of 1, elements of 2, and so on. The size of the stack is actually the element that is on the index of the element that is on the top of the stack, and that should always be less than the capacity of the elements array, because we basically can only store that many elements as we have in that array. The moment that the size becomes equal with the capacity and we have a push, we have to duplicate the elements array, basically have an array of double the size, because we cannot change the size of the original array. We can create a new array with double the size, copy the elements from the old array into the new array, and then continue with pushing elements until the capacity gives us space to do that. So now how do we implement it? First, we have a private integer array elements, a size which is by default 0, a default constant, default capacity of 16. Then we can create a stack of integers calling the second constructor with the default capacity integer. The second constructor takes an integer capacity and creates an array of elements with that integer capacity as the size of the array. Now, the push method is similar to the one that we wrote for adding students in a class. If the size of the stack is greater than equal with the element's length, that basically means that we cannot add additional element because then we don't have space for it in the elements array. So we create a new temporary array with double the length of the original array elements. Then we copy the elements from the elements into the temporary array, starting from index 0 in elements into the index 0 in the temporary array. We copy the number of elements which is in the element's length, so we basically occupy half of the origin of the new array temp, and then we redirect elements to this new temp array. At this point, we have enough space to store the next element, so elements of size plus plus. So elements of size is assigned value, and the size is incremented with 1. Pop will return the element on the top of the stack, which is actually elements of size minus 1. But we also decrement size, so we do it with a pre-increment operator, which basically pre-increments size and then returns the element from the top of the stack, the element with the index, the original size minus 1. Pick does exactly the same thing, but it doesn't actually change the value of size. So minus minus size has a side effect of decrementing size with 1. Size minus 1 does not change the size. It just returns the value, which is the size minus 1. And the get size returns the size of the stack. There was one more method, and is empty, which actually returns true if the size of the stack is equal with 0. So let's implement a stack of integers and actually see how it works. So again, we are going to Eclipse. We are creating another file. Today we had a lot of files. This will be called stack of integers. So we are going to create an integer array. Let's use private variables to be encapsulated elements, and an integer size initialized with 0 at the default value, and also a constant default size. Next, we define the constructors. So we'll call another constructor with the default size. And now we have to implement that constructor. It's really the capacity that you are actually passing, not really the size. But the name of the constant can be actually changed later. Let's actually refactor it and rename it to capacity. And now we can create elements as a new integer array of the size of that capacity. Now we can implement the push method. That takes an integer, let's call it n. And now we have that implementation. If the current size of the stack is greater than equal with the capacity, which is the length of the array elements, then we should create a new integer array temp of double the size of the original array. We should copy the elements from elements starting at index 0 into temp starting at index 0. And the number of elements is elements.length. And we should redirect the elements array, basically the reference that is stored in elements, to temp. So at this point, if we assign two elements of size plus plus the element n, it basically we have enough space for it. And the other methods that we need to implement are pick, which returns elements of the size minus 1, pop, which decrements the size with 1 and returns that element. So we don't really actually delete the element, we just decrement the size with 1, so we don't have any more access to that element. And get size, which returns the size of the stack, and is empty. Which returns if the size of the stack is equal with 0. So now in the main method, we can actually use this stack of integers. Let's assume that we create a stack. Let's call it S1 for stack 1. It's a new stack of integers. And to S1, we can start pushing elements. So pushing, let's say, the element 1 into the stack, pushing the element 2 into the stack, and then see what we get as the result of popping elements from the stack. Last that was pushed will be popped first. And we can continue until the stack is empty. So this will print the elements in reverse order as we push them. We pushed 2, we pushed 1, then 2, then we popped 2, and we popped 1. And we can actually basically mix them. Now at this point, we can push elements again. Let's push 3, maybe push 4, then pop 3, push 5. The state of the stack at this point is that we have in the stack 5 and 3. So when we print the last two elements, it prints 5 and then 3, which is the bottom of the stack. So we see that we pushed one, we pushed two, we popped one, then we pushed three, we pushed four, we popped four, then we pushed five, we popped five, and we popped three. And that's exactly what we did. Okay, any questions? Okay, excellent. Good. So strings are objects. In fact, we can create new strings either by passing the string, the actual sequence of characters as as an input. And since strings are used frequently, the Java provides a shorthand initializer for creating strings, where you basically specify the strings with double quotes instead of creating them on the spot. And they are objects. Basically, they are immutable objects. When we have s is equal with Java, and later we assign HTML to s. In fact, s was initially a reference to the string object that contains Java. The content cannot be changed, so when we assign HTML, we actually create a new string that contains HTML, and we have a reference. We assign the reference, the address of that new string to the variable s. So the old string is now unreferenced and it will be deleted from memory. And this actually tells us why, when we actually compare strings, we should not compare them with a double equal operator. Because strings, like any other object in Java, are stored as references. So for instance, if we have the same string, like welcome to Java, assigned twice to the variable s1 and s3, they are two references to the same object. And the reason for that is that these strings that are not actually created with a new operator, they are called in turn strings. They are collected during compilation time, and Java keeps a single copy of that string in the global segment of memory. So these objects are created at compile time, they are unique, and S1 and S2 are the same reference. S1 and S3 are the same reference. However, if we create a new string that contains welcome to Java at runtime, that will be a different reference. So S1 is not equal with S2, but it is equal with S3. This is the difference between strings that are created without the new string constructor and strings that are created and with the new string constructor. The strings that are without the new operator, they are intern strings. Basically, they are collected as a pool of unique strings throughout your program. And every time we are assigning such a unique string to a variable, we get the same reference for that unique string. So let's actually see this as an example. So let's create again a new class. We are going to call it test strings. And we are going to create, let's say, two strings, S1 as a new string that contains ABC, and S2 as a new string that contains ABC. If we are printing, if these two string references are the same, it will tell us that S1 equal with S2 is false, because they are not the same. They are two different objects. These are two different references. Therefore, the two references are different. However, if these two strings are created interned, that means that they are created on the spot, and the compiler collects them into a single string, if we compare the two strings, they are equal. So we should never use the double equal operator because it has different functionality for different type of strings. What we should really use is the dot equals method, a method, a non-static method that doesn't compare the actual strings, it compares the characters in those strings. So this will work for both strings that are interned or strings that are created with a new operator. It will compare not the string references, but actually the content of those strings. So always for comparing strings, use the equals method, or use the compare to method. The compare to method returns an integer value, 0 if the two strings are the same, or a value that is greater than 0, like for instance if we compare A with B with A, if S1 is greater than S1, the S2, it returns a positive value, but if S1 is less than S2, it returns a negative value. So compare to returns an integer, which is the lexicographical distance between the first two letters that are different in our string. So for instance, if here I would have had A, B, and here I would have had A, D, A is the same, but then B is less than with 2 than D. So it will return minus 2, a negative integer, which is the distance between the Unicode codes for those two characters, the corresponding two characters that are different in the string, which is also called the lexicographical distance between the strings. Okay, so the class string really has a lot of methods. It has methods for comparing strings, for getting the length of the string, retrieving individual characters with character at from the strings, string concatenation, substrings, basically getting the first the substring from a given index or the substring within a range, start and end index, comparison between strings, which includes basically equals and compare to, string conversions to integers, finding a character or a substring in a string, conversion between strings and arrays, converting characters and numeric values to strings. So the first method is equals. Equals returns a Boolean value, and we should really put it as that. Basically returns a Boolean. Returns true if the two objects are basically contain the same content, or false otherwise. So in our case, even if the two strings are created in different ways, one is interned, the other one is a new string created in the heap, dot equals will actually compare the two strings. So in our case, it will return true because S1 and S2 are actually the same, which is different than actually comparing with the double equal operator, because that really means a different thing. It means that S1 and S2 have the same reference. So in my case, it will in the first case, it will actually return true. In our case, comparing the two strings, we return true, so true in our case, and that is different than as if S1 is equal with S2, which really means that they have the same references, and again in our case is false. Okay. I will update the lecture notes after the class and put it on the website. Okay. Compare to. We said that it basically compares the lexicographical distance between the two strings. So if the two strings have the same value, like welcome and welcome, S1.compare to greater than 0 is false, S1.compare to equal with 0 is true, and it will print that S1 and S2 have the same content. It basically returns a positive value if S1, the object on which we are calling the compare to method, is greater than S2, the parameter of that method, equal with 0 if the two objects are the same, they contain the same content, and otherwise a value less than 0 if S1 is less in lexicographical distance than S2. Most classes in Java implement this compare to method. So for instance, even if you create two dates in Java, they also implement the same compare to method. So you can actually import the class that we talked about earlier today, java.util.date. You can create two dates. Let's actually create them. So date D1 is a new date, and date D2 is a new date. You can create them both for the current date, but you can also create them with parameters. It will basically, you have to pass in the year, month, day, hour, minute, and second, which is a quite a big value. And then you can compare the two dates. D1 compared with D2 should give us a negative value because, or zero, because these are created at the same millisecond. If we would have an expensive task between the two dates, like for instance a big for loop for every integer I that starts from zero, as long as I is less than maybe 1 million, and we don't really do anything, let's assume, then it will return a negative value because we actually have a number of milliseconds between the first date and the second date creation. Okay? So compare to is implemented by most classes in Java. It will be basically an interface that we'll discuss about later. It's called the comparable interface. It allows actually to implement the comparison between any two objects. There are many other comparison methods. You can compare strings without considering the case, with equals ignore case, also with compare to ignore case methods. There are a few more methods that we'll discuss later, which are using regular expressions for strings. Basically, regular expressions are patterns. If you want to identify that a string, let's say, contains a social security number, you can look for that specific pattern. That is 3 digits followed by a dash, followed by 2 digits, followed by 4 digits. Okay. Okay. Next. So there are methods for getting the length of a string, getting the character at a given index in the string, or for concatenating strings, which is also overloaded with the plus method. So for instance, if we have a string like welcome, message.length, we return the length of that string. This is a method. It's not a message, is not an array. It's basically an object, and we are calling a non-static method. So we use parentheses after the name of the method to get the length of that string. We can retrieve individual characters from the string with the character at method, where we pass in the index, and the index starts from zero, and it will return an object, a character, which is basically the character at that index. So for instance, if we have a string, let's actually do that experiment. We have a string message, which is, let's say, hello. We can write a loop for every integer I starting from 0, I is less than the length of that string, and we are using the length method. For every I, we are going to print the character at index I in that string. Okay, so for hello, it will print hello with every letter. For every character, for every index, it prints the character on a new line. So the character at returns the indices, the characters for the indices between 0 and the length of the string minus 1. So the length of this string is in fact 15, so the last character has index 14. Next, if we want to extract a slice out of a string, we can use the method substring. So substring returns the string substring that begins at a character with a specified beginning index up to the end of the string. If we want a slice, not up to the end of the string, we can pass in the begin index and the end index. It will extract the slice, the string, between the begin index up to the end index, not including the end index. So, for instance, if we want to extract the character, the string welcome to space, we have to say that we want the substring from position 0 up to position 11. So the upper index is not actually included in the result of substring. Okay, so let's do an experiment. We had hello, and we want to extract system.out.println. The result of message.substring from position, let's say 1. And that will basically return hello from index 1 up to the end. Let's say that from index 1 to index 3, index 1 is E, index 3 is the second L. The second L will not be included, so it will only include up to the first L. So the return is a string that is EL. Okay. What about converting a string from lowercase to uppercase, or converting from any case to lowercase or to uppercase? It basically, each of these methods returns a new string with all the characters converted to that case, lowercase or uppercase. Trimming returns a new string where the beginning white spaces at the beginning and at the end of the string are deleted. Basically, white spaces includes not only spaces but also tabs and new line characters. Replace old character with a new character. We return a new string where it replaces all the matching characters in the new string, in the old string, with a new character. Replace first only replaces the first occurrence of a substring with a new string and returns a new string. Replace all replaces all the occurrences of a string in a string with a new string. So let's actually see an example. Like, for instance, we had hello and we call message dot replace L with, let's say, with an X. So instead of hello, we have hexo. It replaced every L with an X. Replace all does the same thing for strings. So instead of passing characters, we pass strings. In this case, let's say that we replace the double L with an X. And that will basically replace the double L with an X. Split does a splitting, returns a new array of strings consisting with a substring split by the delimiter. This is a common operation in natural language processing where you tokenize an input string by splitting it on the spaces. So let's assume that we have a string like hello, all, you learn Java, and we want to split this on spaces. We can create an integer string array. Let's call it A, which is the result of message dot split. By default, it will use any white space to split the string. So let's actually add the white space. And let's iterate with a for loop for every element in the array A, which is of the type string. We are going to use a for each loop for every element in A. We print that element. So in this case, we are printing the element followed by, let's say, a comma. So we know that that is in fact an array if in fact we are printing before and after the black brackets. it transforms from printing a string that contains spaces into printing a list of the words in that string that contains spaces. Okay, so here we have plenty of examples. Welcome dot to lowercase returns a new string that is welcome all letters in lowercase. Similarly, in uppercase returns welcome with uppercase. Trimming returns a string, a new string that does not have the white spaces at the beginning, at the end of the string. Replace one character with another character will replace that character in all occurrences. Replacing first occurrence of one substring with a new string returns a new string with a replace the first occurrence, and so on. All of these return new strings, and the reason for that is that the class string is an immutable object. So how exactly, and there is an example with tokenizing, which basically splits a string on a hash sign. So how exactly does this method matching, replacing, splitting works? It actually works with what are called regular expressions. A regular expression is a special string, which actually is not a string. It's a pattern for actually having a disjunction of multiple strings. So for instance, the open bracket dollar sign plus hash sign close bracket means that it's a string that matches either one of those characters. So it's a disjunction of those characters. It tells us that replace any special character like dollar sign plus or hash sign with triple N. So for instance, replacing in this string all of those characters with triple N will give us a new string that every one of those characters was replaced with triple N. So if we have, for instance, a string that contains punctuation signs like plus, comma, colon, semicolon, question mark, we can actually split on any one of those special characters. And I will actually do that. So instead of splitting just on space, let's assume that we have other characters. You, comma, will learn Java. Then we can actually split on the regular expression that says either dot or comma or space are used for splitting. And output is exactly the same. It basically split on space, on period, on comma, and again on space. Okay. What if we want to find a substring in a string? So if we want to find the substring in a string, we basically use the method index of. So index of finds the first occurrence of the character. We can find the first occurrence from a given index. We can find the first occurrence of a string. We can find the first occurrence of a string from a given index. We can find the last occurrence of a character, the last occurrence from a given index, the last occurrence from of a string, and the last occurrence of a string from a given index. In all of these cases, if the character of this or the string is not in the string, it will return -1, a negative index telling us that we couldn't find the character in that string. So again, let's do an experiment. We had this previous string, and I want to find the index of Paul. So message dot index of Paul. So in this case, the index of Paul will be 5 or 6, because let's see, oh yes, we have double L. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and the index of P, the first letter in Paul, is 6. If I'm asking what is the first occurrence of Paul after the index 7, then it will tell me that it's -1. After the index 7, there is no Paul in that list. If I have multiple poles, like one pole at the beginning and another pole at the end, I can ask what is the first occurrence of pole after 7, and it will give me the index of p in pole after 7. If I want the last occurrence of pole, I can ask, give me the last index of pole. And that will give me again 26 because that is the index of the last pole in that string. Okay? So here we have a bunch of examples. The index of W, uppercase W in Welcome to Java. Java is case sensitive, so uppercase W, the index of it is 0, the first character. The index of X is -1, there is no X in Welcome to Java. The index of O after the position 5 is this O, so it returns the index 9. The index of come is 3. Again, we started with 0 for W, E, 1 for E, 2 for L, and 3 for C. So the index of come is 3. The index of Java is, after the position 5 is 11. The index of lowercase Java after the position 5, Java is case sensitive, so it will be -1. There is no lowercase Java. The last index of A gives me the last index of A, which is 14 in that string. Converting characters and numbers to strings. So we can do it in two ways. Java provides a special method called valueOf, where you can pass in a number, like for instance a double, and it will return a string. But a simpler way to actually do this is actually to concatenate the number with the string. So in fact, instead of doing this, a simpler way is to do 5.44 plus an empty string. And the reason why this works is that Java is weakly typed. So basically, it automatically converts the number, which is 5.44, to a string before it does the concatenation of the number with a string. Okay. Now, there is also a special class called character. So character is a wrapper for one character, and it has methods for checking if that character is in a digit, a letter or a digit, if it's in lowercase, if it's in uppercase, if it's it returns a new character to actually represent that character in lowercase or uppercase. These methods we already saw earlier this semester. We actually use them for comparing characters. It basically would do the same with actually using the greater than operators to compare the indices of characters. So, for instance, let's actually do again an experiment. Let's assume that we have some character that a user enters, some random character, car C. Maybe the user entered uppercase F. We can check in two ways if that is uppercase F. Let's actually use single quotes for characters. So we can actually do it with, let's say, if the character class is in uppercase, the character C, then let's say that we print is in uppercase. Or we can do it with greater than operators. So we can check that the uppercase A is less than equal with the character C, and the character C is less than equal with the uppercase Z. Then it's also printing exactly the same thing, that the character is in uppercase. And similarly, if we want to check that a character is in lowercase, we can call the method is lowercase for the class character, or we can compare the character with lowercase a and z. And in this case, it will not print anything because the character was in uppercase. So if we would change it, let's say, to lowercase, then it will print that the character is in lowercase in both cases. If we want to check if the character is a digit, like 5, we can ask if the character is a digit from the class character, or we can compare the character between 0 and 9. And in both cases, we can basically print the fact that the character is a digit. And again, it prints that yes, it is a digit. So here we have examples that basically does comparison of characters. So the compare to method is implemented for many classes in Java. Okay, so let's continue with string builder and string buffer. So the string class is immutable. That means that we cannot actually change a string once it's created. We can assign to it a different string, but we cannot change the original string. In Java 1.5, Java also added two mutating classes. Two classes that actually can be changed if they need to be changed. And in fact, there are certain applications. I personally wrote an application where I was passing between Java and another programming language strings and modifying these strings. And using string builder and string buffer, it actually increased the speed of that application with about 100 times. So two order of magnitude faster application using string builder and string buffer. They have different usability than string, but however, everywhere that you have a string, you can actually use a string builder and a string buffer. We can insert characters at any given index, add characters at the end of the string, append or concatenate two strings, two string builders into the string object. String builder object. So you can create a string builder like we created a stack, either by using a default capacity or by using the default capacity of 16. And it has methods which modify the current string builder. So for instance, we can append additional characters at the end of the string. We can delete characters at any given indices. We can delete entire slices from the string builder. We can delete a character at an index. We can insert a character at any given index or an array of characters. We can replace a character with a different slice from the string with a different string. We can reverse the string in place, and we can set a character with a different character. And here are a few examples. I created a string builder, and then I appended to that string builder Java. I inserted HTML end at position 2. I deleted from index 3 to 4, not including index 4. I deleted the character at index 5. I reversed the string. I replaced a character at index. I replaced the string from index 4 to index 8, not including 8, with HTML. I set the character at index 0 to W, and so on. And all of these are done in the same string. So these actually take much lower time than actually doing these operations on strings. Because on strings, these operations or equivalent operations, because these do not exist for strings, would actually require that we modify each one of those strings and create new strings. All of the methods that we had available for strings are also available for string builders. So for instance, we have length, character at methods, and so on. Now, we can also pass strings to programs at runtime. In fact, the array of strings that we have in the main method is in fact the arguments that we pass to the Java IDE, to the Java JVM when we actually call a class. So let's actually see an example. Again, Let's say that we have our test strings class, and we print out the length of arguments. And maybe for every one of those arguments, we print it. So how do we pass those arguments to Java? We can pass them either from command line by basically invoking Java test, that's the main the method that the class that we are implementing, and the arguments, or in the IDE we can run as a Java application and then run as run configuration, and in the arguments we can actually pass those arguments. So for instance, anything that is separated by spaces or is contained within curly braces is considered to be an argument. So if we run this program, it basically prints that there are 9 arguments to the method, to the class, in this args array of strings. And those arguments are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And the last one is the string that was containing a space passed as a string within double quotes. So these are the command line parameters that are passed when you are invoking a Java program from command line or from the Eclipse IDE arguments when you run with a run configuration. And you can process these parameters in any way you want. You basically have access to the elements of an array. Like for instance, if you are implementing a calculator and to that calculator you pass the 3 arguments, the understanding is that you are running the calculator with operand 1, operator like plus, minus and so on, and operand 2. You can actually check if in operand at index 1, which is the second element, which is the array, the operator, the character at index 0 is plus, minus, and so on, and you can actually parse the integer at argument 0 as an integer, and the integer at argument 2 as an integer, and then compute their sum and put it in the result. Which brings us to regular expressions. So regular expressions is a way to specify a pattern that recognizes not only simple strings, but recognizes if your string, like for instance Java is fun or Java is cool, matches a given pattern. And the patterns really have a set of different regular expressions. Dot means any single character, and star, for instance, is also called the clean star, means 0 or more occurrences of the previous pattern that we had in that regular expression. So in our example, Java is fun matches java.star returns true because it starts with Java and it contains a suffix, and that suffix matches any character as many number of times possible. For instance, if we want to recognize if our string matches a social security number, we can actually use this matches method. We can check that our string starts with 3 digits, followed by a dash, followed by 2 digits, followed by 4 digits. So let's see if this is actually the case. So we are going to copy that regular expression. And let's assume that we had a string, and we don't know if that string is a social security number. We can actually ask Java to do it for us. We can ask Java, does my string s matches this regular expression? And the regular expression is the one in the lecture notes that says it starts with 3 digits, then dash, then 2 digits, then dash, then followed by 4 digits. And it tells me that no. What about this one? And it tells me that yes, this string matches this regular expression. So what exactly is that regular expression? It basically says that I have any digit slash d means any digit, and slash slash d means this slash is escaped by the first slash, and then I have basically slash slash d means any digit three times, followed by dash, followed by any digit twice, followed by dash, followed by four digits. If I want to check, let's say that that this is a phone number, I can basically ask if the area code starts with a 1 or a 9, followed by two digits, followed by close parentheses. Parentheses has a special meaning, so again you have to escape it, because it's used for disjunction of strings. There are many other regular expressions. You can basically enumerate characters that the string contains A or B or C, or the string contains a character that is not A or B or C, or the character is between A and Z, or is not between A and Z, or is between A and E, or is between M and P, or is the intersection between A and E and C and P. So it will find that is between C and E. Similarly, if it's a digit or is not a digit with uppercase D, or if it's a white letter, a word character, or not a word character, or if it's a white space or not a white space, or is a repeated sequence of the previous pattern zero or more times, or is one or more times repeated sequences of the previous pattern, or is zero or one times repeated sequences of the pattern, or is an n times exactly n occurrences of that pattern, or at least n occurrences of that pattern, or between n and m occurrences of that pattern. So these, all of the methods that we learned up to now, like for instance replace all, split, replace first, work with regular expressions. You can replace any V followed by a word letter with a WI, which will replace VA three times with WI, or you can replace only the first occurrence, or you can replace, you can split on any digit within the string. So really, when we design a class, like we design the stock class, or we design the BMI class, the course class, we describe a single entity, and we should describe this class or design the class for reuse. Basically, we should design the data fields of this class that are used in all of the instances of this class. We should provide no argument constructors. We should override the equals method to implement where the two objects are actually equal. We should implement the toString class, which returns a string representation of the class. And those are actually defined in the object class, and we are inheriting them, which is the topic of the next class. We are going to talk about inheritance and polymorphism and dynamic binding in object-oriented programming and Java in particular. So this is the topic of today's class, and we are going to continue with the midterm review after a short break, and we are going to record the midterm review, and we are going to record the rest of the lecture today. Thank you very much, and let's